It's an honor for me to be here. Thank you. Yes, the focus of my research is on development of sustainable agriculture systems, and I have an ecological approach to the research I do. To feed an increasing global population and in the same time cope with climate change and ecosystem degradation, the large-scale, low-productive and extensive mode of food production in industrial countries needs to be abandoned. It might be rather provocative to say this, because we are used to think that we are developed or have developed the most productive and efficient system in the industrial world, part of the world. But I think that there is a need to change perspective on the word efficiency. We need an agriculture that makes a lot better use of land, labor, and local resources, and that produces a lot more benefits to humans and to other organisms. Our present global food system is, as all of the other speakers have said before me, it's contribute to the planetary boundaries that we are overrunning. It contributes heavily to the climate change, to the disruption of the nitrogen cycle, to the rapid reduction of biodiversity, and also to the tipping points that we are approaching. In example, the decreased groundwater levels, afforestation, chemical pollutions, phosphorus depletions, and acidification. Food production in industrial countries are also totally addicted to fossil fuels when we are about to rapidly approach peak oil. And even though we are using so much of the planet's non-renewable resources, we are not self-sufficient in food. The Swedish consumption patterns need an area one-third larger than our own agricultural area. And this is in a world where the population increases. So there is some non-negotiable demands on our future food system, or some requirements that the future food system has to fulfill. We ought to produce more food with less use of water and without fossil fuels. Agriculture areas need to also sequester carbon. We have to drastically reduce the input of new nitrogen, maybe as much as to 25% of today. That means no more nitrogen fertilizers in our part of the world. And no more phosphorus to the oceans. We also have to reduce the extinction of species to maybe one-third of today or less. And the most obvious and crucial thing that we have to do now is to decrease the meat consumption in high-income countries. The good thing of this is that we can eat, if we reduce the meat consumption, we will be even healthier. We eat too much meat today. But the bad thing is that the meat consumption is still increasing in our part of the world. That's incredible. But I think also that a sustainable and climate-friendly animal production is possible if we let the ruminants feed on roughage and allow them to graze on natural pastures. Then they do not compete with us for feed. Instead, they would add to the nourishment of humans, because a large part of the world's agriculture land is most appropriate for grazing. And then animals could help us to collect energy from such areas. And then they also would contribute to ecosystem services, such as maintenance of biodiversity and to the capture of carbon in these kind of pastures. Because these pastures have a large biodiversity in our part of the world, and also capture a lot of of carbon. When it comes to pigs and chicken, apart with that they wouldn't compete with us for food, if they were fed on leftovers, they would be climate friendly, because their impact on climate is mainly caused by the production of their food. But this is by large illegal today, and it has to be changed. We have to build up structures and systems that have a scale to make possible feedback that are felt by us. So if I put something in the dangerous in the leftovers that should be pig food, I risk getting it in my meat. The awareness of the inefficient use and recirculation of nutrients is rapidly increasing, but the trend is going the other direction. An increased consumption of meat, and also an increased consumption of meat that increased the throw flow of nutrients in the system, and also huge concentration of animals in regions and in countries that turn up to be bird producers of meat in large scales industries. And in the same time, an increased demand of fertilizers in other areas producing cereals. This is not sustainable. We have to integrate animals and crops, and we have to again integrate urban and rural areas and to produce food locally. This is because it's so important, because the linear flow of nutrients, of this large quantity of nutrients in industrial agriculture, is caused to acute global and local environmental problems. Besides that, there are limited resources, or produced by limited resources, they also add to contributes to the planetary boundaries that we are exceeding or approaching to exceed. They contribute to eutrophication, global warming, acidification, stratospheric ozone destruction, and to ground level ozone production. And it's so that the total addition of new nitrogen or phosphorus, mainly from the use of fertilizers, is what decides the size of the impact. And the cost of this damage, the problem is so big, so the cost of this damage is of this use of fertilizers is higher than the economic value of the use of it, of these resources or these fertilizers. So recycle is the only solution then. If climate change should be halted, all land use need to contribute to carbon sequestration. And agriculture has to be turned from a source of carbon dioxide to sink. And there is a great potential for this. More perennial crops, increased diversity as art-rich areas sequester more, ecological production and agriculture without plowing are only some example how we could do this. And sustainable food consumption would then be to eat more from perennial systems. International research demonstrates that agroforestry systems, systems like edible forest with trees, bushes and herbs, they are more productive than monocultures. They improve recycling of nutrients. They increase biodiversity. They sequester carbon dioxide. They reduce the need for fossil fuels. And they increase the resilience to climate change. And this is some of the research have been done with by Andres Goncalves, and we have heard him giving us knowledge about all these good effects of the use of agroforestry systems. But the thing is, how would system look like in our climate, and what will we eat if we should eat from such systems? I think that we can learn a lot from the research that you do in tropical regions in the south. And I am happy to be part of initiating research in this area. It's interesting and important, I think. We also need to eat more and produce more in cities, eat more from production in cities. Already today, about 15% of all food is produced in cities, and 1/3 of what the citizens eat are produced there. This is mostly in mega cities in the south. And urban food production increases in low-energy societies and during economic crisis, because it is productive, has low resource use. It enhances recirculation and biological regulation. And no fertilizers, pesticides, fossil fuels are needed. You get fresh and healthy vegetables and fruits, and it can also contribute to social benefits. So, as conclusion, food for a sustainable planet would be less meat from multifunctional animals, food production in urban areas, land use that also sequesters carbon dioxide, more food from perennial systems, and short and efficient recirculation of nutrients. Thank you.
Thank you, Johanna. I also learned that you will stay over the panel discussion, so there will be more room to ask you a question later on. I was thinking about the urban agriculture. How about air pollution? Can it be toxic to eat these vegetables grown in an urban environment? Is that a problem?
It might be, and also soil pollution. So we have to be aware of where we go it and how we go it. Yeah. And already, ground level ozone have damage can damage the vegetables, but not they're not dangerous for us to eat then. Yeah.
But so it's doable, but you have to be careful. But okay. And I think there's room for one question from the audience. If anybody has a question, and if so, please grab a mic and talk very close to the microphone. Any question? One in the back? Have you?
One question about the part when it was it was against the rule to use the natural fertilizing, or what do you call it?
Leftovers.
Why is that?
Because the system is so large now, so you cannot guarantee that everything that you feed the animals are with are safe. It's important. So even if you are a farmer, you cannot take your leftovers from your kitchen and give it to the pigs if you should sell the pigs. It's because we have a global system, so you cannot know where all sources to smitter to infections are. So we have to scale down the system so we can be sure. And there are examples of such systems even in Sweden. And as a fact, I think 50% of all the pigs get leftovers from food industry right now. So one thing would be to label that. So when you come as a customer or in the shop, I can see, oh, this pig has been fed by leftovers from industries. That's the way to start the development, because I think this is really needed.
Okay, thank you, Johanna. Welcome back again during the panel discussion. Thanks.